me in the corner. That's me in the spot. Like losing my religion. Trying to keep up you. And I don't know if I can do it. Oh no, I've said too much. I haven't said enough.
Hello everybody, welcome to the Atheist Experience. We are live Sunday, January 13th, 2008. What was the story with Joy Bear?
Basically, she's a comedian who was on the show on, it says Wednesday, and this was January 10th, so it might have been on the 9th, I assume. And she basically said, I have a theory that you can't find any saints anymore because of psychotropic medication. I think that in the old days, the saints were hearing voices, and they didn't have any Thorazine to calm them down, Bear said on ABC's National Chat Fest. Now that we have all this medication available to us, you can't find a saint anymore. And the spokesman for The View, now again, that's the comment that was said. She's a comedian on a daytime chat show. And the spokesman for The View said Joy was just joking. She said very clearly it was just a theory. She has lots of really funny theories that she kind of gives on a daily basis. She's a Catholic and she loves to talk about the Catholic Church. It's one of her favorite subjects. So kind of trying to cover her up and saying, it's not that bad, it's really not, you know, it's not a big deal. She's a comedian on a daytime talk show. That should kind of lighten the message anyway.
You know why people are upset, though? Because they know she's right.
And actually, it kind of goes back to, I remember doing a story on the show, this was maybe 5 years ago, who knows.
Showing off, huh?
Well, gotta do it when I can. When I get the chance, I gotta put it in there. But anyway, it was in one of these churches in somewhere in the East, can't remember. But there was this famous like prophet lady or something who would always have these mystical visions, stuff like that, and people would come to her advice. And they found out that where this church, I mean, it was a real church, actually existed. She actually existed and everything. And they found out that they did like studies on it, and the gas in the rocks and stuff like that below that, if you spend a lot of time in there, you're going to whack up your mind. And so it's possible that, you know, I mean, if she was constantly living in this church, she was always exposed to these, you know, noxious gases coming from the rocks and whatever, she was just a little bit nutty. So.
It reminds me, you know, I remember scenes, and this scene's been played a few times, so it's nothing original, but you'll have somebody who, you know, is seeing something like a ghost or whatever, and somebody else will reach out and take off their glasses and wipe it and put it back on. And, oh, wow, where'd it go? I can see clearly now.
Yeah. But. Yep. Thus the drugs. Bayer's co-host, Elizabeth Hesselbeck, blasted Bayer's theory, noting that the late Mother Teresa, who has not yet been given sainthood, is a modern example of a saint. Bayer mentioned the recently revealed letters that suggest Mother Teresa struggled with doubts about her faith and contended that the Catholic Church's standards for sainthood have changed due to medical advances. That's why Mother Teresa had issues. Let's not forget she didn't really believe 100% like those saints who were hearing voices. She didn't hear voices. So.
Yeah, and, you know, I realize that, you know, the Catholics get to make up their own rules about who they get to make a saint, but you know, in any real sense, I think in order to for somebody to qualify for sainthood, and I realize, yes, this is an atheist saying it, I'd like to think that they'd have to be, oh, I don't know, good people, and not some evil harpy who encourages suffering around the world, as you know, God really wants you to feel the pain thoroughly so you appreciate your life. Yeah, don't come to me with Mother Teresa was a saint because I'm not buying it.
Yeah.
And now, of course, they've kind of built up this out now, because of the letters where she expresses that she may not have actually believed for most of this time.
Yeah.
So evidently, all those evil things that she did with regard to suffering were her atheist side spilling over, because we're just really bad.
But of course, other people have to still back up Mother Teresa because of this. And saying, clearly she is no church historian. Saying she didn't believe 100% is a simplistic and superficial reading of the news. Why would you spend 60 years in a slum in the name of Jesus out of love for God if you don't believe in Jesus or God 100%? Well, The problem there is, what if she didn't do it for the love of Jesus and for the good of God for 60 years? What if she were doing it because she thought she was doing a good job to actually help people? That's a possibility. Even if she didn't believe, she could have been doing it because she thought she was doing a really good job. And the argument could be made that she did. So.
And the argument could be made that she didn't.
True.
I happen to think that she didn't. And I don't think... here's the thing. And it doesn't matter whether she believed in a God, actually, or believed that God was telling her to do things, or that she was doing stuff for God. She, as Daniel Dennett has put it, would have been somebody who believed in belief. That and not just strictly accepting Catholic dogma. I don't want to oversimplify it. But believed that both Catholic dogma and these broader principles of a God and helping people were good things. So on some level, I would agree that she probably felt that she was doing good things. The problem is that her definition of good and helping differed drastically from mine. Because if you bought into this idea that suffering is a good thing, that we should, because it makes you feel more alive or teaches you more about life or makes you appreciate the moments when you're not suffering, that to me is a rationalization whose only real purpose can be the promotion of more suffering. Yeah. As a matter of fact, if that's your mentality, then what you'd really want is almost constant suffering. Because the more you suffer, and the smaller the gaps are where you're not suffering,
the more you appreciate those gaps.
The more precious those gaps are.
Yeah.
I mean, it just has to be that way. Now, I differ from her in that I'd like to see us do everything we can to eliminate suffering entirely. Let's broaden those gaps of periods without suffering. And then maybe, when we do have to suffer a little bit, instead of appreciating how much better the non-suffering time is, we'll be able to go, ooh, we're pretty sure this will be over soon.
Yeah, I've never been a big fan of the whole suffering for its own sake, or you learn better, you appreciate something if you had to work hard for it type mentality. I can understand the concept and the rationalization of it.
I have no problem with that.
But I still view it, this is kind of going back to, again, a while back I was reading over, I can't remember the guy's name now, but he did the different books with Jesus. Good Lord, I can't remember the name of it now.
Robin Price.
No. The Case for Christ.
Oh, Lee Strobel.
The Case for Christ. And basically saying that we are suffering and there is pain and suffering on this earth because then we can learn better from it. There are certain lessons that we learn better through suffering. And I disagree with that in the sense that a parent will have their children suffer in a certain way because there's no other way to do things. As in, you will make your, newborn infant suffer through vaccination shots where doctors have to take them away and stick needles into them so that they don't have a greater suffering later on from polio.
Sure. I mean, that's kind of a practical...
Exactly. And so if there were a better way to do it where the child didn't have to be taken away and didn't have to cry, that would be preferable.
Yeah.
God, being almighty and all-knowing, can figure out a way that we can learn everything without having to suffer. We do it because it's necessary. There's no other practical way of doing this. There's no real practical way to learn history without just plain reading and studying.
Yeah.
So you've got to go through that. But God could just plant the knowledge in. Absolutely no suffering, no time taken, and you learn it.
Yeah,
you don't.
Or as this omnipotent creator control of the universe could just frickin' eliminate suffering entirely.
Exactly. Exactly. And if you're an all loving, all powerful being, that should be the goal. That should be the goal.
And if you can't, then clearly there's some set of rules that's greater than God. That's me in the corner.